वेलकम टू पार्ट 5 ऑफ द वीडियो ऑफ चैप्टर नंबर 15 लाइफ प्रोसेसेस इन लिविंग ऑर्गेनिजम्स फॉर स्टैंडर्ड 9th सब्जेक्ट इज साइंस 2। चिल्ड्रन लेट अस बिगिन दिस वीडियो विद एन एक्टिविटी बेस्ड क्वेश्चन। द क्वेश्चन इज समटाइम्स व्हाइल ईटिंग वी बाइट आवर ओन फिंगर और टंग बाय मिस्टेक। सो what could be the reason? Sometimes while eating we overfill our mouth with food, so during the process of biting the food there is misalignment of activities, that is the order of the activities which should actually take place in order becomes incorrect, and therefore we bite our own finger or tongue by mistake. So this happens because of lack of coordination. Then sometimes we are dehydrated, so the muscles of our mouth and tongue do not function properly, and this can also lead to biting of our own tongue. At times we are distracted with other activities while we are eating food, that is we may be talking to others or we may be watching television, so distraction with other activities can also cause us to bite our own finger or tongue. So basically there is lack of coordination while eating which results in the biting of our own finger or tongue. The second question is, sometimes we choke while eating in a hurry. So this is the food intake that has happened from the mouth. This food has to pass from the mouth into the alimentary canal. The first organ, or the you can say the organ which is immediately next to the mouth, is the food pipe, which is also called as the esophagus. But there is windpipe also in front of the food pipe. So there is a flexible flap like structure which is present at the opening of the windpipe, and this structure is called as the epiglottis. This epiglottis opens up whenever air has to pass through the windpipe, but it closes the windpipe whenever the food has to enter into the food pipe. So when we eat in a hurry, when the epiglottis opens up to take in air, food also moves along with the air into the windpipe, and therefore the choking takes place. That means there is lack of coordination. So due to lack of coordination, we choke while eating in a hurry. In multicellular organisms, many tissues, organs and organ systems work in perfect coordination with each other. So our life goes on smoothly. For example, when we eat food, we locate the food with our eyes. Our nose registers the smell of the food. Our hands pick up the food and puts it in the mouth. The mouth opens to eat the food. Teeth help in chewing the food. Saliva helps in mixing with the food. So you see, many parts of the body are involved in performing just a single task. So there has to be coordination between the different organs of our body. If there is no coordination between the organs, then there will be complete chaos or confusion in completing the activity at any step. So coordination means orderly execution of various activities. We will now be studying coordination in plants. Plants do not have a muscular system or a nervous system just like animals. So coordination in plants takes place through movements, and these movements are in the form of responses to a stimuli. So what is meant by responsiveness to stimuli? Let's take an example. In this case, you can see that a boy is touching a hot object. So what is his response? He has immediately withdrawn his hand upon touching a hot object. So touching a hot object is an external stimulus, and immediately withdrawing our hand on touching the hot object is our immediate response to this external stimulus. Another example, when a mosquito bites us, we slap that place. So biting of a mosquito is an external stimulus, and our response to the stimulus is hitting that place or hitting that part of the body. So our immediate response to an external stimulus in the environment is called as responsiveness to stimuli. So also in plants, movements are in the form of responses, and these responses are given to an external stimulus. In plants, movement or growth of a plant takes place in response to an external stimulus. So this movement or growth of a plant in response to an external stimulus is called as tropism or tropic movements. There are two kinds of tropic movements seen in plants. They are growth dependent movements and growth independent movements. Let us see the types of growth dependent movements in plants. There are four types of growth dependent movements in plants. They are phototropic movement, gravitropic movement, hydrotropic movement, and chemotropic movement. The first type of growth dependent movement is called as phototropic movement. Phototropic movement is also called as phototropism. Photo means light and tropism means turning. So we know that whenever the shoot or whenever the stem grows, then the shoot or the stem of the plant always moves in response to the stimulus of light. So this movement which is shown by plants in response to the stimulus of light is called as the phototropic movement or phototropism. Stem or the shoot system of the plant always show phototropic movement or phototropism. The second type of movement is called as a gravitropic movement. Gravity means in the direction of the earth. Tropic means turning. So we know that the root system of the plant always moves in the direction of gravity, that is in the direction of the earth. So this movement of the root system in the direction of gravity or towards the source of gravity is called as gravitropic movement or geotropism. Geotropism is also called as gravitropism. The third type of movement is called as hydrotropic movement. Hydro means water. Once again, the root system of the plants always grow towards the direction of water. So in this case, the growth of the root is in response to the stimulus. And what is the external stimulus here? The stimulus, external stimulus, is the presence of water. So the movement or the growth of the root system of the plant in response to the stimulus of water is called as hydrotropic movement or hydrotropism. The roots of plants always move towards the source of water. The fourth type of movement is called as chemotropic movement or chemotropism. Chemo means chemical and tropism means turning. So when the movement of a plant takes place in response to the stimulus of chemicals, then the movement will be called as a chemotropic movement or chemotropism. An example of chemotropic movement takes place or is seen during the process of fertilization in case of plants. In case of plants, when a pollen grain lands on the stigma of a flower, the pollen grain starts developing a tube-like structure which is called as the pollen tube. Now this growth of the pollen tube is in a directional manner, that is, it takes place towards the ovule. The ovule is located inside the ovary. Now, the reason for the development of the pollen tube towards the ovule is that the ovary of the flower releases certain chemicals, and in response to those chemicals which are released by the ovary, the pollen tube develops a calcium gradient, and this calcium gradient, which is present at the tip of the pollen tube, helps in the elongation of the pollen tube and thereby movement of the pollen tube towards the ovule. Okay, and so a positive example of chemotropic movement is growth of pollen tube towards the ovule. Another example of chemotropic movement can be the growth of roots takes place in the direction of the minerals which are present inside the soil. So the direction of, or you can say the movement of the roots of the plants in the direction of minerals or to the external stimulus of the minerals which are present in the soil is also an example of chemotropic movement in plants. There are certain movements in plants, and these movements do not result in the growth of the plant. And such movements which do not result in the growth of the plants are called as growth independent movements or nastic movements. It is the hormones which are present in the plant that brings about various movements in the plants in response to the changes that are taking place in the surroundings. So some of the examples of growth independent movements in plants are: lotus flower opens in the morning. Lotus flower blooms in the morning, isn't it? So opening of the lotus flower is not resulting into growth of the lotus flower. It is just a movement of the petals of the lotus flower. So opening of the lotus flower in the morning or blooming of the tuberose at night, that is ratrani, hamesha raat ko bloom hoti hai, khilti hai. So blooming or opening of the tuberose at night is an example of growth independent movement. This is a Drosera plant. Drosera is an insectivorous plant. Whenever an insect comes near the tentacles of the Drosera plant, the tentacles curve inwards or curl inwards, thereby surrounding the insect or trapping the insect. So the curling of the tentacles of the Drosera plant inward when an insect touches the tentacles is an example of growth independent movement. Similarly, there is a fruit called as the balsam. So the fruit of the balsam bursts open with an explosion, and that happens at an appropriate time. So when the fruit bursts open, the seeds are scattered in different direction by the different agents of pollination. Plant hormones. Plant growth, development, and responses to the environment takes place with the help of chemical substances which are synthesized by the plants. So such chemicals are called as plant hormones or phytohormones. These hormones are synthesized in very minute quantities. Also, these hormones are synthesized at one place, but they have to act in another place where the action has to be brought about. So this happens by the process called as diffusion. So plant hormones are the chemical substances which are secreted by the plants to perform some functions. They also bring about movements in plants in response to the changes that take place in the surroundings. Some of the different types of plant hormones are gibberellins, auxins, cytokinins, abscisic acid. Auxins, gibberellins, and cytokinins are the growth promoting hormones. That is, they enable the plant parts to grow. Whereas abscisic acid is a growth inhibiting hormone. That is, presence of abscisic acid in a certain part of a plant stops the growth of that particular part of a plant. So auxins help in the growth of stem and the roots. They also prevent the premature falling of roots, flowers and leaves. Gibberellins helps in the growth of stem. Cytokinins help in cell division. But abscisic acid prevents or inhibits the growth, which leads to wilting of the leaves, yani leaves ka murjha jana, closing of the stomata in the leaves, and the seeds and the buds become dormant because of the presence of abscisic acid. Dormancy is a period in the life cycle of organisms where the growth and their activities are temporarily stopped. So the seeds and the buds are stopped from growing temporarily because of certain reasons, and that is caused by the presence of abscisic acid in them. Cytokinins are found in large amounts in fruits and seeds. Cytokinins are the plant hormones which promote or which lead to cell division. Cytokinins are always present in greater concentration or greater amount in the region wherever rapid or fast cell division takes place. And rapid cell division takes place in fruits and seeds. And therefore, cytokinins are found in large amount in the fruits and in the seeds. You must have seen that when a potted plant is kept near the window, the plant bends in the direction of sunlight. The reason is that we have studied that the stem of the plant shows phototropic movement. So the movement of the stem or the shoot of the plant is in response to the stimulus of light. Now, whenever a plant detects light, then a hormone called as auxin is synthesized at the tip of the shoot. This helps the cells of the plants to grow longer. Now, when light comes from one side and falls on the plant, the auxin starts diffusing. It starts moving to the shadier part of the plant. So, the concentration of the auxin stimulates the cell to grow longer on the side of the stem or the shoot which is away from the sunlight. And therefore, what happens is, because of the concentration of auxin, elongation of cells takes place in this region, and therefore the stem or the shoot of the plant bends towards sunlight. You must have seen these supporting structures in some plants like the pea plants, and these supporting structures climb up on the other plants or on the fences by means of these supporting structures called as the tendrils. So tendrils are supporting structures which are seen in those plants whose stems are weak. These tendrils are very sensitive to touch. Whenever these tendrils come in contact with any support, then the part of the tendril which is in contact with the support becomes sluggish, that is, that part does not grow rapidly as the part of the tendril which is away from the object. So due to this, the tendril starts entwining itself upon the object and clinging to that object. So this makes the weak stem to climb up. If you touch the leaves of chui mui plant or touch me not plant or mimosa plant, you will find that the leaves begin to fold up and the leaves droop, that is, they appear to fall off. In this case, the leaves of the mimosa are sensitive to the stimulus of touch. So the response of the leaves of the mimosa plant is seen in response to the stimulus of touch. This movement, which is seen due to the response to the stimulus of touch, is called as the chiasmonastic movement. In chiasmonastic movement, no growth is seen in the plant. When we touch the leaves of the mimosa plant, we find that the leaves curl inwards. Here, growth of the plant is not involved. The plant actually moves in response to the stimulus of touch. These plants do not have any nervous tissue nor any muscle tissue. Then, how do plants detect the touch? And how do the leaves move in response to the stimulus of touch? Now, if we exactly look at where exactly the plant is touched and what part of the plant actually moves, it is very clear that movement of the plant takes place at a point which is different from the point of touch. If this part of the plant is being touched, this part of the plant is also showing movement. That means the information that a touch has occurred must have been communicated in the plants. So plants make use of electrical or chemical means to convey this information, and this information is transferred from one cell to another cell of the plant. Plant does not have any specialized tissue for conducting the information as in animals. That means the cells which are present in the plants must change their shape so that movement can take place. So plants change their shape by changing the amount of water which is present in them, thereby resulting in either swelling of the cell or shrinking of the cell. And therefore, we see that changes takes place in the shape of the plants, and that helps in the movement of that particular part of the plant.